Hello everyone, a very good evening to all of you. I'm Pooja Bothra from Economic Times HR World and your host for this session. In this fireside chat organized by Plethora and ETHR World, L&D and HR experts have come together to share their insights and experiences on capability development in the post-pandemic era. Let us meet the experts today. Riaz Mullah, leading the learning and talent development in Tech Mahindra for more than two decades. He's also a facilitator, coach, and therapist. Welcome to this show, Riaz.
Yeah, hi. Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon. Pleasure being here.
Palani Sami Annamalai. He has two decades of experience in multiple industries, and at present, he is the AVP L&D and head of training, Samsata Microfinance. Welcome to the show, Palani Sami.
Hi, thank you and good evening to all.
Last but not the least, we have Amit Gautam. Amit has over 17 years of experience in delivering high-end enterprise scale learning technology solutions and services, and he's a CEO and director of Plethora. Welcome, Amit, to this show.
Thank you, Pooja. Hi, Palani Sami and hi, Riaz. Thank you for being here today. And hello, everyone. I hope it is a great session for all of us.
Viewers, thank you for joining in. We want to make this session very interactive. So please keep sharing your questions and take this conversation in the direction that you want. We will take your questions throughout the session. We begin the session now. Developing new age skills are critical for the success of your teams. Let us first look at what remote work specific skills is critical to keep remote teams flexible, competitive, and engaged. Let's start with you, Riaz.
Thanks, Pooja, for that. See, a couple of things have changed post-COVID and post-this remote. One is the acceleration of digital. So no matter which business you are in today, not just into the space of technology, but no matter which business you are in today, it's become very important that you adapt to technology and adapt it very faster. So technology skills today definitely have become very important, very essential. Depending upon where you are, it doesn't mean that if you are in the management layer, you need to understand that aspect of technology which impacts you at a management level. So no matter which level you are, no matter which department function you are, your ability to understand technology and how technology influences your part of the business, I think that is very important. If you take that away, if you keep that aside, I'll speak on another area, which has also become extremely important in remote, especially in this age where almost everybody is working as a remotely and a single person, is emotional intelligence. And what do you mean by emotional intelligence? Emotional intelligence for the last few years has always been, among the World Economic Forum's top 10 skills. But it gets a very different meaning here. Whether you talk psychological safety, whether you talk awareness, acceptance, and acknowledgement of your challenges, whether you talk about dealing with fear, anxiety, stress, and to a large extent, especially after the wave two, also dealing with loss. And that requires a very well-developed sense of emotional intelligence, not just where we began with a couple of years back. And I think on one side, the understanding of technology and how technology impacts my work. The second is a very high level of evolved emotional intelligence. I think I would put as these two as skills which have become very relevant in today's world.
Very interesting, Riaz, and I totally agree. You know, tech skills, everything is happening on technology platforms today, and emotional skills are equally important in these, you know, vulnerable times when things are changing so rapidly. Palani Sami, I would like to know from you also what kind of skills are playing a prominent role when you are designing your learning programs.
I'm with Mr. Riaz, I would like to add a few areas where, first of all, the stakeholders like L&D or management also should develop a soft skill kind of a thing. How to sell this changes, which is frequently happening in the technology side, to the end last mile user. unless until the person who is in the field adapts and starts using, whatever you invest or you perceive or you try to become is not going to be useful. So the way the leaders carry forward the message to the end user, this is the benefit, this is the reason that you have to start adapting to the new learning, which is bigger challenge. Because we, with a lot of enthusiasm, we design and implement the program, which is useful for them, but they just take it one another thing given by the company. Okay, sir, we'll see that. So that should be addressed effectively. Otherwise, the investment of time and effort of everybody will go for a task. So that is a one area where the leadership part has to develop their skills besides on other aspects. That's what I mean.
Interestingly, readiness to learn is a very important quality which is required to do different kind of learning. So, you know, you learn to also learn and relearn and unlearn. Amit, going to you, what kind of content are you creating? You know, given this, Riaz and Palani Sami has told us about what kind of skills they require the workforce to develop. So how are you helping them out? What is your proposition there?
So in fact, what we have seen in the last almost 18 months or so, there's a big tug of war happening between the various stakeholders, and not like at individual level, but like businesses have to survive this wave, and they have to, you know, let alone, I mean, leave the growth part. I think they have to just survive and go through this phase and come out as a survivor.
Palani Sami, my next question to you is that what kind of digital tools are you using to create a learning ecosystem, you know, from top to bottom line, across demographies? What kind of tools are you using?
Yeah, before that, I would like to say our experience before usage of digital tools to the maximum. And we were saying very traditional kind of approach we had some few years back. And one of our challenge was our field force, about 7,000, out of 7,000 employees, 90% of the people are spread across country in remote location, not because of COVID. We are, as a microfinance company, we operate in the rural areas. So when we were having this traditional approach of training, a very little intervention of this thing, and due to various other factors also, learning is one of the parameters, the attrition was huge, 100%. So when we analyze, the learning methodology need to be reinvented or redesigned with a lot of other interventions. So that way, we started using a lot of digital approaches. Either when the new employee joins on the day one till he completes the classroom session, till and again when he goes to the field, then validation, then he goes to the original location. Everywhere we combined a blended approach. There will be one-to-one approach. The same day or the next day, there will be tools like in the LMS, he gives a feedback today what all he did. And he will take an assessment on the same day. Then another day, he may be taking a e-learning module, or we may publish small bite-sized videos, some kind of awareness. So it's a combination depending on the content that we wanted to give him and the objective they wanted to meet. So when we explored, so that is, I think Amit will agree, we also have a lot of support taking from Amit's upside LMS. So they also helped us in bringing a lot of reachability once they leave the classroom. So various digital tools we use, and that is helping us for the past 2 years. I would say the attrition from 100 plus has come down to 50% in the front level employees. So usage of tools have helped us, and I can't list down the tools, but there are plenty of tools depending on the content and the purpose we use it.
We have Amit also back. So Amit, you were also sharing, and you know, Palani Sami took that time to also share that you helped them create some content for the digital tools. So now my question to you is, what is the strategy of following to, you know, plan this content?
So as I was saying, what we have been observing is there's a tug of war happening between the business objectives of, running the business and, at least surviving. The other objective being, keeping the employees safe and their well-being at a high priority. And the third is actually more personal to the employees, that while they understand the situation, they also know that they have to be productive. So they are under pressure to do more because, at one point, almost 20% of our team was not available. So somebody has to do the work. The work will go back on somebody else's shoulders. So as an employee, I have to do more with less time. But the third factor also make sure that, and the, you know, what Mr. Riaz initially said, that, you know, the changes are now very, very, you know, pervasive. It means the employees have to learn a lot of new skills. You know, like Mr. Palaniswamy was mentioning and Riaz was mentioning about the psychological safety, the mental well-being, the leadership skills at the L&D level, and all about the attitude about how we go about this approach. So I think we had to really, you know, before COVID, we were offering a lot of ready solutions to our customers. You know, you offer e-learning, micro-learning, but we have to now factor in all of these things along with things like digital fatigue or Zoom fatigue. And, you know, people actually burning out, you know, they're spending more hours working from home than they used to do in office. So we have to very carefully curate programs and actually work with our customers in a very consultative approach that, you know, what worked before COVID will not work now because it puts people at risk. So in terms of, you know, instead of having a 1 month program, can we create a 2 month program? Instead of having a module of 20 minutes each, it may be just 5 minutes each, maybe videos, maybe small bites of learning. So our focus has been to, one, not put the employee under pressure of learning something. It has to be something which they need to learn, but they do not have to spend an hour or they, because they're already working so hard during the day, they don't have time and energy left to retain anything from the learning. So it has to be within the workflow. So we have tried to work with the customers to make sure that the learning journeys we design, the content we design, it all aligns with, you know, and I know, I think this is something we have seen and this is really good, is that all the companies we have been working with, they have put employee well-being and health at number one priority, which also gave us a lot of, you know, kind of backup to say design the content and journeys accordingly. So I would say our focus has been to create, you know, offer smaller solutions, spread out across a little bit more amount of time. And, but yes, I think we have been backed up by the L&D fraternity in terms of we understand how important that is. And as Mr. Palaniswamy, Mr. Riaz mentioned, you know, the well-being is driving the fact that we are not loading the employees with a lot of content. It is all driven by the learner. They have to demand something. So we are just trying to ensure the employees understand what do they need to learn and that they need to learn this for their own and the company's benefit. And then we offer content which aligns with those strategies. So that's what we have been working at our site. So
really makes sense that you have to offer what they want. You have to give the learners something that they would want to learn. That kind,
yeah,
of
can freedom, I just add a point, yes, when you're about specificity? If you take our my employee group that we are dealing with, they are not well versed in English. So when we come to when we create the content, we go to the examples which are pertaining to their area of living, or which will touch their lifestyle, or even the language that we choose. We always translate all the content, give it to their comfort. We are not looking at, we are good in English and we will give it in English. I can give an example from US, but I can also give an example from a village in Bihar. So which one will reach my participant? So that we spend a lot of time and energy so that it touches the last employee in his own way. So that is very, very important. That's what also I just wanted to.
Yes, and I totally agree. And I also feel that, you know, even examples that we take, you know, in teaching a particular concept or talking about one particular idea also should be more local example. You know, somehow the books that we read and, you know, even in college, some of these are very, very global examples. It can work in the urban areas, but maybe in rural towns, I think probably there is a gap there. Riaz, I would also like you to share in Tech Mahindra, so as to say, what kind of digital programs are you using in for learning and development of your talent? How are you creating the ecosystem? And to that, also, there is an audience question that has come. What are some of the challenges faced in organization to embrace digital learning methods? So maybe you, that can be the second, yeah, part of your question.
No, but I think what you use the right word is you need to set up an ecosystem. Because there are different needs that learners have. And when you are earlier dealing them in small cohorts in classrooms or in virtual instructor-led sessions, it was easier to engage that. But now the people who need videos, the people who would love to listen to podcasts, the people who want to listen to training while they are driving. So there are various preferences that are there. And there's hardly one way of doing things. So what is And I also saw one question on how do you identify trends in an unknown trends. See, the only way of dealing with that we have learned, or at least I would say only because that's the way we have learned, is with small experiments. So you have to experiment with different formats, experiment with blended formats, see what works for whom, and as Amit rightly said, provide flexibility. Because the challenge, as you said, I'll take that the first part, second part you said, the challenge is in digital adoption. The challenge is in adoption. The challenge is also is that while you get down to bite size, how do you still bring in effectiveness? Because finally, it is effectiveness that determines, right? It's not the number of hours, it's not bite size or whatever you do. Ultimately, for the business, what is important is how effective it is and have things being able to improve after the training program. And for that, even if it is in small bites, but the participant has to spend time, okay? So the need to spend time has not gone away. It's only our attention span and our fatigue that is there. But the amount of time that I need to learn a skill to be able to practice it, that time has not reduced. That time still remains the same. So how do you bring it into the ecosystem? And that is where experimentation is important. Some of the experimentation that have worked very well for us, I'll take two or three, is something which we started something known as a habit tracker. Now, what is a habit tracker? Okay, because finally, if you see in leadership or anything, it's about identifying new habits and being able to put those habits into play. That is where change will happen at the work. So we identified for the new KPIs, new KRAs, and the new results outcomes to happen, what are the challenges? What are the behaviors that the participant needs to demonstrate at work? We translated those behaviors into training programs and also into actual actions. So for us, behaviors are actions. So we converted them into actions and said, for this, these are the 6 or 7 different actions or habits that a participant needs to build. And we created an automated habit tracker where we would pop up for the participant every day that this was the training program that we went through. This was the module. And these are the habits. How many have been able to apply today? Okay, and this happens on a daily basis post the program, because habits are only built daily, especially initially you have to spend time daily on a habit. Okay, and that keeps on coming up. Okay, and we thought initially probably the participants may not like a pop-up coming every day telling them, have you practiced this or not? And these were program managers, so people with 20 years experience, etc. We realized after the first 3 weeks or so that that practice started to catch up. And they like that is because this was a habit that was helping them. And they like that every day they were being reminded to put it into place. And in fact, that has now become one of our key success things, whereas there are some other things which did not work, which we tried as well. So the whole idea is you have to experiment. You have to experiment with and use technology there, the habit tracker. We created something known as action learning assignments. And earlier, you said, many of our action learning assignments used to be global assignments taken from the past. What we did was, we now created assignments rather than we creating assignments. We asked the participants to create assignments from their work stack as well. So it was assignments in the flow of work. So I have a meeting tomorrow with a customer, and if I am told a framework which I need to practice, I can identify that meeting to practice a framework, and I say and say, yes, I practice this framework and this is the change I saw. So which means that I don't have to do an assignment, additionally spend time and do an assignment. It happens in my flow of work. And that has also started for us to give good results, because there again, we don't have to worry about effectiveness, because automatically the participant is attempting a new habit in his or her work area, which means that if the change is to be seen, is automatically seen in the work area by the manager. So some of constructs like this have helped us overcome this challenge of one adoption and the challenge of having to spend still time practicing a skill, though our attention span and time to learn are reducing. I think I can elaborate further as time progresses.
Yes, sure. Palaniswami, there is a question from the audience that wants you to, explain them how LMS is helping the newcomers in the organization. And that too, it's helping them to be more engaged and more attuned to organizations, you know, workflows and purpose?
See, every learner comes with an experience. That's the basics of adult learning principle. So we always classify which he can do it on a self-directed learning. So the classification of content which should go for self-directed learning plays a vital role. So once we pick up, these are the things he can learn on his own. Then the challenge is how to present it, as the time span, attention span is very less, how to present it. So we ensure that the presentation depends on the content. Say there could be some animations, there could be some reward-based assessments, gamifications. So we involve everything so that the learner finds the change in approach of learning program of 20 minutes. There are about 6-7 approach changes. So this ensures that the LMS is being used by the person regularly, continuously. And moreover, see, it's not always the interest. It is also what is in it for me if I do it regularly. So we have, what we have done is we have a career development center, in-house career development center. So we are attaching every completion of his LMS courses or bite-sized video, whatever we upload, or assessments. So we give reward points. So you do this many courses in this month, this many scores are added. So when you are getting eligibility, we have added this as an eligibility criteria to apply for any next level position. One side, we are focusing on the content and the deliverability model so that he continues to learn because of interest. Another side, there's a purpose for him. His career assessment will be done based on the courses that he has completed. For every level, we have defined. So that is helping us, both the approach, helping us. LMS is being used, even the youngest guy who joins newly also, he thinks today if I don't complete, maybe after 2 years, I may not be able to attend any interview, promotion interview. So that is the approach which is helping us to make LMS successful.
Very interesting, Palani Sami. Amit, there is an audience question which I would like to ask you to take. The question is, given the challenge of limited resources available to our country like India or similar countries within South Asia, what are some of the innovative solutions to implement the change management in these countries where resources are limited?
I'll just narrow down the focus of the resources to the business, because the change management is dependent on the resources a business has to process the change. And in my understanding, and of course, we have more experts also here in the panel today, is that the change management is actually a process of the leadership. It is how your leadership of the company is tuned towards the entire, because change management is not an event or an incident which happens in a day or a month. Every day of a company is a change management process in some way or the other. Of course, pandemics like these ones or situations like these ones, they just kind of are magnified examples of change management. But even in these scenarios, the resources, I would say, would be not the first factor. The first factor is how does everybody in the company right from the top kind of adjust to that change? What did they first react to? In any situation like this, there's a reaction. There is a kind of an adjustment to the reaction, and then you plan for the future. And I think the whole package is called resilience and how resilient you are as a business. So I would say more than the resources, because resources, you can always find innovative ways to use resources. And I think the biggest resource we all have as a business is our people. And any business will have enough people for their kind of objective. So I think that is not resource crunched. So it all depends on how resilient we are ourselves as company and how resilient our people are. And in fact, that is one of the things we have been working with our customers in the last 18 months is, how do we build this resilience for now? And how do we build it for the future? I think what Mr. Riyaz, Mr. Palani Sami are saying is that it is all about building that behavior of the learners, helping them understand the need for learning, because it finally drives from their individual motivation and needs. We can put bite-sized learning, we can put a big learning module, but eventually the learner has to find the need and the motivation to go through the program. And for that, it has to align with their personal goal, and there has to be goal congruence between their goal and the company goals. So if I want to, as a business, maximize my profit, and that's it, it may not work very well with people in today's time. In today's time, I think there is an emotional, as Mr. Ria said, emotional intelligence. Everybody has to implement that in their behavior. So I think the change management is best handled by how the leadership reacts to the situation, how they let their people feel safe and secure in the environment, and then take everybody along in that change management process while also building the skills along the way. So, you know, it is like hitting the ground running, because in the last 18 months, the skills are all, you know, not all, but a lot of skills are new. You know, number one new skill is digital transformation. Even a person selling non-technical service or goods is now first going through a digital process. I think those are the things which I would say would be crucial for any change management activity.
Thank you, Amit. Very interesting. So we've already spoken about, you know, learning ecosystem, blended learning, digital tools, bite-sized learning. So we've spoken a lot about what skills are required in the workforce. What are the different ways in which content can be used, you know, innovative ways. Now coming to aligning it to the business goal. So Palaniswami, my question to you is that, you know, how do you make sure that whatever you're creating is directly aligned to your business objective? And even the business objective is going to change and is changing rapidly. So how do you tackle that?
Biggest issue with the L&D phases in the traditional way, all the years, even today, is that once an intervention is designed, he becomes a creator as well as accountability, owner of the accountability. That's a one approach. But what I feel and I implement is that if a business productivity is considered as a vehicle, there are four wheels. The first wheel is the management. The way management supports and facilitates driving of the program, that plays a vital role. Then, of course, L&D, the way you do training need analysis, the way you select the evaluation tools, and the design and delivery. Anyway, we love to design and deliver at the earliest, but there are other factors. So that is there. But the other part is the user, the end user, how he buys the value in that, how he uses it. Unless until he adapts and uses, so how are you going to make him use, how are you going to make him accountable for using this intervention given by the management? The fourth important factor is that the supervisors, every level supervisors, unless until they drive the program, unless until they give the right feedback to the candidate when he is implementing, unless until they pass on the feedback to us, where is it going wrong, where is it going right? So what we do after the training need analysis, evaluation tools are selected, the important thing we do is we sit and design the 4-point accountabilities. What L&D will do, what all management will do, what the supervisor has to do, then the what we expect from the learners, how to ensure that he does it. So when this responsibility is fixed up and a tracking mechanism is identified, where how we will track, how we will publish, whether everybody is doing their job. So when everybody is aligned in ensuring that we reach the final objective of business productivity, then seamlessly the vehicle starts moving. Once we stop thinking that only he is responsible, L&D says, I have trained, it is up to the person to implement. It will not work. So you need to time to time intervene, where is it going wrong? That's what when you said the changes, milestone will keep changing. Business cannot run as per L&D's design. We need to run as per business design. So we need to be in touch with the stakeholders where there is a gap is happening, how that can be addressed. The gap and the addressed decision can be ideally given by the supervisors because they know whether this is working it or not. And even L&D is sometimes not, L&D is hesitant to ask such feedback. Will they give right feedback, wrong feedback? That should be removed from our mind. So if we touch all the four parameters properly and move and accountability shared, then the things will work. But that is a big challenge. That's a big challenge. Nobody is ready to take accountability unless L&D sells it properly. So that agreeing point is very, very important. That's what I would say.
Yes, and I'm very happy that L&D is actually getting that position in most organizations. In today, it's not a support function, but it's becoming a mainstream function in most organizations. Riyaz, to that, my question to you is that you've been in Tech Mahindra for 20 years and a lot has changed. I don't even want to talk about 20 years back, but even in the last 6-7 years, so as to say, and then these last 2 years. Yeah, and then these last 1.5 years, you know, I mean, some kind of transformation started taking place 5 years back, you know, with the startups and Amazons of the world and Netflix. So my question to you is, you know, how do you see this change? How would you articulate this change? One. Second is also, you know, how are you developing talent to take in senior positions in your organization rather than buying talent from outside, you know, from limited talent pools. So, you know, building internal talent to take critical position due to business transformation, as well as articulate the change for us.
If you see the way the change has happened is, if I were to, and it's a question that will require a lot of reflection, but a few things which I have seen changing, and I'll say it from the top of my mind, is one is moving towards a journey-based programs, where we realize that even a 2-3 day offsite done very powerful, if it is not intermeshed with few measures to make it sustainable, then it does not work. So I think having journey-based programs to make it sustainable, and that probably has helped us bring in a learning ecosystem. How do you have a learning ecosystem in place, which is, so I would say the role of, and let me take one area, because what the question you asked is very big. Let me focus on one area, on how the role of the learning function has changed over the years. And what I have very clearly seen is that from, as Palani Sami said, from taking a requirement, designing and delivering, which was largely the scope, the whole focus is now changing to how learning function becomes just enablers rather than the deliverers, how we facilitate learning, and how we create a learning experience for the learner rather than just content. So creating this overall learning experience, and that means that roles have changed from faculty and operations, which used to be largely the two areas of operations and faculty, to a learning experience designer. So when you have a journey, you need somebody who can design a journey to keep a learner engaged for 6 months. Okay, and that's a challenge. But you need, how do you do learning design? How do you, how learning metrics have changed? Okay, so if you look at learning metrics from coverage and from number of days and number of people covered and reach to business parameters that may be relevant for that, for that particular business. And when you are saying business context, and that's why the context has become important. And that is where knowing the business, for a learning function to know the business is important. If the learning function does not understand business, you cannot design an effectiveness journey. So it has to begin with the learning function. So whether it is the change in metrics, whether it is the change in the ecosystem, whether it is change in the roles of the learning function, whether it is change in the learning culture from being prescriptive to organization saying these are the 5 trainings which you need to complete and 40 hours which you need to do per year, to saying these are the learning avenues and these are the requirements and these are the roles coming up, and these are the career learning paths, and now you start building your skills. So moving from a prescriptive to a very very democratic way of learning, where you shift the onus on the learner, I think that these are some very fundamental shifts that have happened over the years. I know I'm sorry for a longer answer, because but no. The question was had made me think
of course,
a little
retrospective.
Okay. It was a very reflective retrospective, but I hope I have done justice to that.
Yes.
Through some of those things. The second part you asked, I'm sorry, I missed the second part. What was the second part you asked?
The second part of the question was that, you know, why is it important to build talent to take new
how
positions?
How do you build internal talent? I think for us, and every industry will have its own, but for us, what has become very important is to build role-based skills. So how you identify the critical roles? So even in leadership, you may have roles. Okay, for us, for example, the sales roles, the program manager role, the solution architect role, the full stack developer role, which is a new role. So you have these roles coming up across the layer. Okay, and right from your client partner who is front-ending the customer and now has to act as the CEO of that account, to the developer down below who has to now work as a full stack developer, and she needs to know development, testing, and middleware, not 3 different areas. So right from a full stack developer to a client partner as a CEO, there are critical roles, and it's important that you have what our approach has been to build journey-based roles, journey-based programs across each of these roles. Because you have a strong client partner, but a weak program management layer, that will kill your program, because you may get business, but you may not be able to deliver that. Okay. So any role, any of these roles, if you do not build, and each of these roles, we have 2 flavors. One is the flavor for somebody who is doing the role, and one is a flavor of somebody who will get into the role. Because both of them, for somebody who is doing the role, so there is an incumbent curriculum and there is an aspiring curriculum. So I'll have an aspiring program manager who will have a curriculum, and an incumbent program manager will have a curriculum. And so role-based approach with an aspiring and an incumbent flavor is how we are trying to build in internal talent.
Pooja, can I add a point in this? Yes. Why we should develop internal? To be put on the lighter side, always the employees, today the culture has changed. Working in the same company for 5 years, 10 years, Shrihas, is becoming less and less and less, because other side seems always greener nowadays. There are always people looking at you. Their company employee is good for me. My company employee is good for others. So unless until we start showing them the my employee, there is a future. You can, and by showing them the developmental activities, not only by telling you have a future, you develop him, he feels that there is a scope within my organization, and he starts sticking to you. By sticking to the company, you ensure that the legacy of the value that you wanted to pass on in the organization remains. Otherwise, new people coming every year, every once in 2 years, we do not know what is our culture at all. That is one. And moreover, hiring from outside does not guarantee success. But at least developing an internal resource can assure you, to some extent you will do, you know what is happening. So that kind of a approach in internal development, L&D can play a vital role from the day one. We have to show them how he can grow if he remains in the same organization, what are the benefits he can get. So that's what I feel. Internal development of talent is very, very important, which we are getting into an aggressive mode. We are, the whole company is deciding to set up the CDC in a very bigger way, and we are working on it.
Very true. And internal talent development, you know, directly helps in attrition, like you, reducing attrition, like Palani Sami said, and helps in retention and keeping the employees engaged and give them good experiences. Amit, there is an audience question. I also recall Riaz talking about full stack developers. That is one, technique or skill, so as to say, most leaders who come to our webinars talk about it. So the question is, what are some of the trending courses, unique solutions, and flexible plans that are cost effective for budget constraints?
In the last 18 months, as I said, before COVID, we used to have a different approach of how we work with the customers. And as a company, we have now access to about almost 1 lakh courses to be able to offer to our customers. But, and you know, most of our customers before COVID, they used to buy access to the full library, they'll use it. It worked well. You know, we have a lot of effective courses. But I think after, when the COVID thing started and remote workforce kind of happened, we also realized that that is not a strategy which is going to work for everybody, in future. So what we did was, we have now come up with, a very flexible approach where, as I was telling in the beginning, we are able to design learning journeys with our customers. And, within that, the customer is free to choose whatever they want to pick and mix into that learning journey. There is no restriction from our side that you have to go to the entire library or just 4 courses or 20 courses. Because in end of the day, as Mr. Riaz said, whatever you deliver to the learners, it has to be effective. And if we just give them like a dump of courses or e-learning modules without thinking much, it will actually backfire in today's situation, because they're anyways fatigued. Instead of using the courses, they'll actually come back and say, this is not done. This is not fair, because we already have less time to do things and you're giving us so many things to look at and you have to decide for ourselves. So I think it is very important to work with the learners first. I think Mr. Riaz and Mr. Palani both mentioned the same thing, that first we work with the learners, understand what we really need to deliver, how can we enable their journey. And then as a provider, we work with our customers to make sure that our mapping is aligned, in sync to that thing. We are not here to kind of impose any offering. We are here for customers to choose what they need. Let's say, for example, in the last, a year or so, we have seen digital project management, digital transformation skills for middle managers or new joinees, and digital marketing skills. So multiple things, but a lot of digital first approach to the skills which we already were there, but they have now become digital first. So that's what we are doing from our side. We are trying to work with our customers to be as flexible as possible. And I think it is working well, because we have seen, some of our customers, like a far large pharma company in India, they have a remote workforce. So they already had a remote workforce, but now they also have a remote white collar force. So, you know, they adopted mini or micro courses and multiple modules, so e-learning, then some virtual ILT programs. So I think it's as for the customer. So we are able to work with our customers and very flexibly in our approach in that sense.
And I think what is very important to realize is that today content is increasingly becoming available free. So content is no longer the thing. How you are able to bundle that content or integrate that content and make it of sense to the learner, and how you can give the learner a choice of mediums through which learn is going to be important. Because so no longer the learning function is to focus on the content. Content today is becoming more and more available freely. Anybody wants
content? And our biggest competitor is Google. Yeah. L&D's biggest competitor is Google. People just Google and they get whatever they
want. Yeah. And I think L&D should see it as a collaborator. How do you then take the strength of Google and a YouTube, okay, and start looking at them as collaborators who are doing one part of your job, so that now you can focus on the experience design, you can focus on effectiveness, and you can focus on elements like coaching, etc., which are still very difficult to do online.
So Riyas, one question that has come from audience, I would want you to take this one, is can we reinforce leadership accountability through learning and development initiatives?
I would want to understand that what is meant by leadership accountability in that question. I don't know if you can unmute and ask, or is that possible? Or if that is not, then so I will, if I look at it, how do you transfer ownership to the learner, if that is there? And I think I love what Palani Swami talked about, the four wheel thing, where in any learning need, you identify what is it that the manager has to do, what is it that the leadership has to do. The way we do it, and I love the four wheel thing, the way we do it is in any need identification, we identify the training requirements and the non-training. If my client partner is not able to sell effectively, or if my program manager does not communicate effectively, one element may be a skill, knowledge, behavior, attitude element. The other element would be in terms of I challenge the customer, but my boss goes out and then agrees, which means that I eventually have to go and do it. So what is the use of challenging the customer? Okay. So is there an alignment in terms of reporting? Is there an alignment in terms of KRAs? Okay. And that may cause certain behaviors in the sales and the delivery people. So if you do not identify the non-training needs, so we identify the training needs, we identify the non-training needs, and we share with the owners and the sponsors that these are the non-training needs and they need to be fixed along with the training needs. Many times the business is also aware, but many times training becomes a very easy solution. So they go for training, but when they see the whole picture, then we have seen that business realizes the need to set some of those things in place as well. So those are my understanding of the question. I hope I got it right.
I will just add one point only on this, just one line. Making the management aware, as Riyas was telling, that for everything they give to training, it is, as per the survey, there's only 20% of the situation where training intervention can come into the role of improving any issues or productivity or attrition or whatever it is. That should be made very clear to the management or leaders that 80% is lying somewhere else. We need to identify and address it. So that 80-20 has to be addressed properly. That could probably give them more accountability. It's not always training, but it is also me have to play a role.
Palani Swami, last time that we spoke, I remember you were also mentioning that, you know, some of your workforce come from, you know, tier 3, tier 4 towns, and maybe they're not proficient in English. So how are you kind of, you know, converting your L&D content in rural language or in regional languages, so as to say, one? And secondly, also when you hire freshers, how are you using the onboarding time, you know, to upskill them and get them ready for the workplace?
Field force that we operate for an L&D, it's one side, it is interesting because they are ready to listen to you. The other side, even though they are ready to listen, their capability is very less because of the education background and the place they come. So the first question was how we, what was the first question? I think I was on the second question.
No problem. So first question was
language. Yeah. Yes. Say for example, let us take a person who is in Bihar, or Uttar Pradesh or Gujarat in Tamil Nadu, which is typically Tamil only dominated area. But as a trainer, initially we were even hesitant because it was very easy to give in one language, that is English. We can design properly when we can give it and we can push it to whatever the system we have, go through. But the thing is, at least classroom, some kind of effectiveness method you can do, kind of an online learning or a video or bites, how to measure the effectiveness unless until he understands. When a supervisor asks, what is that one video you gave? What was the learning that you got? Recently, I'll give you an example. One of the stakeholders asked that today, because of the lockdown, customers are hesitant to give money. It becomes an irritated environment. They shout, and my guy also starts shouting. Can you give a small awareness program where he controls his emotions? So I asked him, what do you want him to do? I will give you a video, hundreds of video, but what do you want him to do at the end? At least for me, he should tell me, if my customer shouts it, I will tell her that, madam, I will come in some other day. Can you do that? So this, if I had to communicate, if I put it in IFA English and download some content or add and it, he will not even believe. So we had to design a local language, local level content, stories, examples, and show him, then take the commitment. So what we have done internally is that we have set up our own audio theater, recording theater, because even voiceover is very costly. It can run crores when we want to have multiple programs. I think Amit will agree. Voiceover is very costly. So we have set up our own theater and we are using our head office resources. We don't recruit from outside. There are, in the head office itself, there are multiple language people. So we take them, we use them for voiceover. We pay a very encouraging kind of motivation, token of appreciation, we pay. So that means whenever we want to translate, within one day, the translated language is ready, we can push it through our LMS or whatever the model. So that is helping us. We are getting feedback. It is simple. It is easy. So that gives us happiness to continue this mother language approach. That is the first part. The second part, freshers. Freshers, when they come, freshers means banking process like microfinance process is very tough to understand. By the time you understand, the process would have changed. So resilient of the learner should be kept intact. So what we do is that we have kept the orientation for about 3 months, divided into three phases. The first phase is full of classroom. The classroom also has a clear blended approach. He will have his own tab in the classroom. Every learner is given a tab. He will do the simulations, whatever the business applications we have. We have almost 150 simulations we have. So it is uploaded in the LMS. He will go through the simulation there itself, prove to the trainer that he has done. We will check it in the LMS, video-based demonstration, you will be able to do that. Kind of, that's the first week goes. The moment he goes to field, we will not put him in the work. We are giving him under a mentor. The mentor is also trained and certified by L&D. So the mentor knows what all has to train. And during this mentor period also, evening, he has to go through online courses, take up assessment, give digitally feedback what he has done to, that particular day. So we analyze, we take interventions. That goes for about 20 days. So in this period, the person gets confident, at least I can do the job. We are bringing him to that level. If not the productivity, at least he feels that I'm independent, I can do it. Our intention is to make him independent. The second month and third month, what we do is every week, there are modules, there are assessments, supervisor guided feedback sessions we have arranged every week for next 2 months, what you have done, where you have done. Then slowly we start giving the target also. So the real life work and as well as learning goes hand in hand. So in the 3 months, continuously L&D supervisors, the tools, when they're engaged, this person feels, why not I try for a few more months? That is enough for such a young guy. Why not I try? So the attrition in the first 6 months bucket will drastically come down if you give him that confidence. And we have seen it. That's what I said in the beginning. From 100 and plus, it has come to 50. So it's a 3 month, we take time. And my management is good enough to wait for the guy to come up. So that is why we can expect a long-term productivity also, even with the fresher. That's what is our experience.
Very interesting. Amit, coming to you, where do you see India Inc., in leveraging L&D while hiring freshers from campus? Are they doing enough? What is your ask, L&D, as a company serving, business world? What is your ask from these organizations? What is that you want them to change?
Yes, I think what Samastha Nagar Finance and Mr. Palaniswamy just mentioned, that's actually a very good approach, especially for freshers. Because one thing which most companies do not have, and they don't have the liberty to have it, is the patience with the newcomers to get ready for the new world. And this last few months have only made it I wouldn't say worse, but more accelerated. Because with the attrition happening and business still going on, and you have new people coming in and they're working remotely, there's a lot of apprehension everywhere in terms of how are they being prepared. So I think the number one ask will be patience with newcomers. And that does a lot of change, because when we show patience as a business to our people who are joining us, we are also demonstrating that we are here to work with the people. It is not just a one-way street that we extract something and then we put it in business. The whole idea is to grow the person patiently, slowly, and work with three phases or four phases. You teach something, then you experiment, you learn something from the feedback, then you give them time to improve, and then again you go back to the same thing. I think that is a strong way to demonstrate that the newcomers are welcome in the company. Of course, we know a few companies actually start their pre-joining training activities. That time could be used to educate them about the company, the values, the future. And I would, as a business owner, my principles are not totally in the favor of that to a large extent, but because they don't start working till they join, so there is a risk that some of them may not join. But yes, I think it's a risk we can take. So some pre-joining activities could be done, but not very heavy. But as Mr. Parinami said, Mr. Riaz was mentioned, the tech stack or the full stack developer. I think the introductions to those things could be started before people join. The banking processes or things which are critical, but they are common in general. So even if you have 200 people joining, they all need the same thing. So a common part of your activities could be transferred to pre-joining stage, however is possible. So I think these two things will definitely help a lot. But I would say the overall, a long period. So we have to give them time. We have to give them a lot of time, and we have to let them make mistakes, but also stand by them when they make a mistake and they learn from that. I think that is very important. And I have seen, as I said, in the last 18 months, even for the people in the company and newcomers and new joinees, I have seen, and as L&D is taking a stronger role, a lot of empathy is there for the learners. And that, I think, is a very wonderful thing to have, is to give them time to learn, because everybody is different. And they are doing so much in the day. We just can't have a 5 to 7 p.m. program for everybody. It does not work like that. Some people learn better without Zoom. Some people learn with camera. So multiple things. So I think empathy and understanding each learner would be the key. Of course, at scale, like Tech Mahindra or Samasta Microfinance, these things become a real challenge. But again, then we are here to solve challenges. So that's where we are.
Sure. We've heard enough in these last 2 years that, machines will replace humans. Jobs will become redundant. And so here also we have a very concerned viewer who's asking the same question. Can you name few of the roles which will become redundant going forward and some new roles which will emerge in emerging economies owing to the technological era? Riaz, would you like to take this one?
So you want from the L&D space or you want from the overall? Overall, I think there are enough research reports and enough reports out there to look at that from an overall perspective, we ask. Okay. But we are seeing that very clearly the roles in the space of automation and technology. Okay. So roles around architecting, roles around integrating technology and integrating experiences, roles around behavior, and since experience, is such a individual thing. Okay, so humans are not going to go away. Okay. As long as humans are not going to go away, the needs are going to be same. All of us are having needs for an experience is a very individual thing. Now, when you have to deliver to an experience, you have to integrate technology with behavioral sciences. And I think what is going to be important is people who are will be able to integrate these elements. Okay. So gone are the days when an engineer would say that arts and humanities is nothing to do for me. And a humanities student say that technology is nothing to do for me. I think for people who are able to integrate these things, people who are able to cross-functionally train themselves and skill themselves, people who are going to think from this and that rather than engineering, maths, or science, but who are able to integrate this and have a more integrative thinking, I think those skills are going to be important. Don't worry about the roles because names are changing. You know, people, there used to be digital media marketing. Now everybody is a digital media marketing expert. Okay. In 2 years, everybody will, there will be some other name in other next 1 year. Okay. And people call themselves, if you go on LinkedIn, I'm fascinated with the kind of titles people give themselves. So I would not worry about the roles. I would worry about what are the skills needed. And I would say the ability to integrate, the ability to entertain two different thoughts, so cognitive flexibility that you said, ability to entertain two different ideas, which may be very different because for one target audience, something will work. For the other target audience, something else will work. And both of the thoughts may be completely opposite to each other. But I as a developer or I as a person providing that service, if I may say that, should be able to work on both and make both of them possible. Okay, so this ability to have cognitive flexibility, the ability to collaborate, as we talked about, how I start looking at my competitor as a collaborator. Oh, if YouTube is now providing so much of content, how can I start looking as YouTube as a collaborator and then build an idea completely different around that? Because that gives me now an opportunity to work on something very different. And how do I, so my learning agility, my ability to collaborate, my ability to integrate, my ability to have cognitive flexibility. If you're able to build these abilities, I think you need not worry about what kind of roles will come up. You can create your own role.
Just put it in one line. It's no more survival of the fittest. It's survival of the latest. If you can upgrade, if you can develop yourself, not only survive, you will grow. So whatever be the role, whatever be the
risk. And I think the risk here for organizations and for individuals is thinking about survival. If you only think about survival, you may probably be thinking about the moment, but the future is going to be here and future is going to be here sooner than we think. So you have to think survival and you have to think growth. When you think both, then you'll be ready for the future, whatever that future is.
Any closing remark from you, Amit, on redefining capability development?
So I think, you know, just to summarize what Mr. Riaz and Mr. Palaniswamy have been speaking throughout the last hour is, you know, and just to add to the last point is that the roles will all change to include emotional intelligence as a very big component.
Absolutely.
You know, as of now, there are, if you look at a developer or a programmer or a customer service person, the amount required of emotional intelligence is actually different, which is going to be a big change because what we have seen in the last 18 months, especially when we all, I mean, not all, but most of us will be working remotely for the next 1 or 2 years or on and off. I think the way we connect with human beings, even without meeting them, the digital transformation and how we are able to still be a bond with each other. You know, in my company, we're a small company, but we hired about 30 people in the last year. And I haven't even met them in the last 1 year. Now, how do they understand, you know, the company, the values of the company? How do we demonstrate to them? When you are in an office, you can demonstrate a lot of skills to your people. You can demonstrate a lot of values. So I think that emotional intelligence is required, going to be required for each skill, for each role. So I think for us, you know, at Plethora, we are focusing on helping our customers build capability from this perspective. That yes, technical skills are all there, as Mr. Riaz said, you know, and Mr. Pranayusen said, you know, Google, YouTube, we have everything is there. But how do we ensure that aligns with our objectives of a business? How do we use the content in the right way to be effective, but also take care of the employees in a way that the learning does not become a burden? It becomes a fun way of doing new things. Upskilling, reskilling, they're going to be required, you know, to either create room for new people, to have, build internal talent, But I think the focus has to be on building the people at the core level. You know, every human being in the company has to build strong, resilient. That would be, I would say, the key to our future.
I totally agree with what you said, Amit. Very nicely put out there. So I'm conscious of time. So it's time to close this webinar. I would conclude by saying capability development is a business imperative, and organizations are partnering with learning specialists to design an effective learning ecosystem to facilitate flexible, scalable, digital, and emotional learning programs. Thank you, viewers, for joining in. Thank you, speakers, for taking up time and being with us.
Thanks a lot. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, everyone.
Made us think a lot. Thank you.
Thank you, Pooja. Thank you, Riyas. Thank you, Amit. Thanks a lot.